Welcome to Christ the King Church, Shelby, North Carolina.
I want to welcome you this morning to our School of the Bible here at Christ the King. My name is Sam Parsons. I'm one of the associate pastors here. And we're going to pray before we get into the Word. We're studying Psalms. So we'll start here and we'll pray and get into the Word of God. Father, thank you for our time of coming together today. I ask you, Lord, to open up your word. Let us truly see and hear what you have for us. I do thank you, Lord, that truly the Holy Spirit is our teacher. Holy Spirit, feel free to move among us. Make sure we receive today, Lord, what you have for us. Let us be open to receive it as you pour it out upon us. In Jesus' name, amen. As we're studying, what's happening is here in our study book is we're focusing on a couple of specific psalms. The one we're going to focus on today is Psalm 85 is the first one. So if you have your Bible there, I'll be reading. This is out of the NIV, but this is Psalm 85, and we'll read the first seven verses, and then we'll talk about them a little bit. It says, "You, Lord, showed favor to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people and covered all their sins. You set aside all your wrath and turned from your fierce anger. Restore us again, God our Savior, and put away your displeasure toward us. Will you be angry with us forever? Will you prolong your anger through all generations? Will you not revive us again that your people may rejoice in you? Show us your unfailing love, Lord, and grant us your salvation." As we've been studying the books of Psalms, of different Psalms that are written here, the thing that continues to jump out at me, and you probably heard me say this before, and I hope you see the pattern, but usually in the Psalms, no matter how bad things are, one of the first things you generally see in the Psalms is someone thanking and praising God for stuff he's done. And you know, that's the hardest thing for us in our human nature to do. When things start going bad, to be honest, that's the times we should start recalling how good God's been to us, all the things he's brought us through in the past, and it makes our problems seem so much smaller. I mentioned this, I think, one within the last week or two, but the thought process is, and I heard a guy say this, and I thought that's so true. We need to learn to get our minds off the problem and on to the problem solver. Once we get our minds onto the problem solver, those problems seem so much smaller and they're so much easier for him to fix. But we tend to want to dwell on the problem. We want to talk about the problem. But Psalm shows us a good indication. This Psalm shows us, here's a good way to start. Start talking about how good God's done is. And the things that he's done in the past. You know, all of us have had things that we've gone through. And if we were to sit and just really stop and meditate, and even just think about the last problem that you had and how God brought you through it, the current problem you've got wouldn't seem so big because you're like, well, if he's already done it once, he's brought me through that problem, he's going to bring me through this problem. But we tend to magnify the problem a whole lot more than the one who solves our problems. And he wants us to learn to do that. And that's what always impresses me about the way the vast majority of the Psalms start off. If you look at Psalm 85 as we just read it, the first few verses, we read 1 through 7, and especially the first three verses are all talking about how good God is. You showed favor to your land. You restored the fortunes of Jacob. You forgave the iniquity of your people and covered all their sins. You set aside all your wrath and turned from your fierce anger. Now that's a mouthful right there of how good God has been. And what they're saying is, you go back and study it a little bit more, what's happening is God had every right to be angry. The Jews had disobeyed him. They had basically turned their backs upon God, and God had a right to be angry. And he was angry for a while. But see, that's the thing with God that you even see with how he dealt with Israel, was that he didn't stay angry with them. He wanted them reconciled to him. So he may have to be angry, and he may have to pour out some wrath upon them to get their attention. And when they finally realize what they'd done, as soon as they were ready to come back to him, he was already ready and willing to accept them back. So we look, in this particular psalm, we're talking about the time where he'd already restored them once. Now we get into verse 4, and it starts talking about restore us again. So apparently, we try to think, guys, we try to think that we are so much better than some of the folks that lived back then. We try to think we're smarter, and in some ways we are. We've got more scripture and things like that, but what I'm saying is, I look at this sometimes and I say, gosh, these people went against God, they got sent off into captivity, they got delivered and brought back. You'd think they'd learned their lesson. And they did for a while, but then they turned right back. Yeah, Jim? And that's one of the good things, too, is how just God is. Even in captivity, as Jim just brought out, the ones who were obedient to him, he kept his hand upon them. The ones who weren't, they were the ones who really caught the wrath of God. But, you know, it really kind of just, it bugs us to say, well, you know, they saw what happened to them when they didn't obey God. And yet they went right back and did it again. And they're in the same boat in Psalm 85 where they're having to say, restore us again because we've messed up again. And we really need you, Lord, to come and restore us again. Put your displeasure with us away. We have a tendency, all flesh, all people, I guess, is a way to say it. We have a tendency to want things our way. Now, as we get mature, we learn to walk with God and to want to have things His way. But we still all have times when we want things our way. In our timing, what we want. Well, that's not what God wants. Well, I don't care what God wants, this is what I want. And apparently, that's some things that they had done. They had gone their own way and had walked away from their covenant with God. We don't understand covenants nowadays. Shoot, we can't even keep treaties. I grew up in a family where we were, you know, part of my mom's family was Indian. And she used to talk about when she was in high school, she used to get in fights all the time because they'd start studying about the Indians and all the treaties and stuff. And she would get mad because, you know, there was not one single treaty that the U.S. government ever made with the Indians that they didn't break. Not one. And she'd get mad about that and almost get herself kicked out of school because she was too vocal about it. We don't understand even a treaty, much less a covenant, which is a whole lot deeper than even a treaty. Now, as far as the Indians were concerned, a treaty was as the same thing as a covenant. But we don't understand covenants. We've gotten to the point where we don't. And it's even more important when that covenant is with God. So important. These people were in covenant relationship with God, and yet they just couldn't seem to get it. What did that mean? And what do we need to do? And I think we still sometimes don't understand that. Here they are crying, restore us again. They were in trouble because of their sins. They were having all these issues. And he mentions, now, I'm not going to get into it because it opens big cans of worms. This is the bad thing when you study as much theology as I have been, is you get into some of these cans of worms that are not always as clearly defined as we'd like for them to be, because there's so many theologians and they all have their own ideas. But it was clear in the Old Testament that God brought punishment on His people. Now, there's people today who will tell you, oh, God doesn't bring the punishment. And I believe that's true. But I sure believe he allows some things to come. I believe a whole lot of it is like with Job. You remember, it talks about in the book of Job how God had a hedge around Job to protect him and everything he had. And the only way that the devil could get to him was God had to let down the hedge. Then he could get to Job. That's the way I really believe our relationship. We've got a hedge about us, but nothing comes to us that God doesn't allow to come to us. Now, it says, I believe he provides everything we need to be successful and overcome that. But I don't think anything comes to us that God didn't allow. I don't think the devil's got enough power to attack us otherwise. So, that's the way I look at it. Absolutely. So, I mean, the scriptures tell us that he'll allow some things to happen, but he'll make sure we're equipped and able to handle them. So that's what's so important. But it clearly tells us in the Psalms here that God was the one who brought this punishment on them. He allowed, again, he allowed others to come, other nations to come and attack them and take them in captivity and do all kind of things. But it was because of their own sin. And he gave them opportunity after opportunity. He sent them prophets. He sent them people to warn them. And they didn't pay attention to them and continued. So I think it's important for us, one of the lessons we can learn is keep your spiritual eyes and ears open. When God's trying to send you a message, get tuned in, receive it, and try to see what you need to work on. God has a lot of reasons, it says, for allowing suffering, and I do believe that. One of them could make us more sensitive to him. You know, if we never had any problems, if we never had any things to deal with, we wouldn't realize how much we need him. That's when I realize how much I need him, is when things happen that I can't handle. I can't take care of them. It's beyond me. And if I never had to go through those situations, it'd probably be pretty easy for me to think I can do it all on my own and I don't really need God. But he allows a lot of these things to come upon us to say, look, guy, you really do need me. You really do. Now, sometimes during the suffering, we can be made aware of sins that we have in our lives, and it's time to deal with them. And that's times we need to really, as I say, step up and deal with them. But it's important for us to realize that suffering may come just to help bring us closer to God. It also may help us see something in our lives that needs to be dealt with, and we really need to step up and deal with it when those things come up. God wants to see us, you know, we've talked about this before. In our Christian walk, we talk about going from glory to glory to glory. The scriptures talk about that. And you know, each one of those steps is a step in maturity. And those steps come when we make changes and recognize things that we have to deal with in our lives. At maturity level comes when things that you used to think were okay, God reveals to you that they're not okay, and so you deal with them and you stop doing those things. Or things that didn't have priority with you in the past suddenly now have priority with you. And you realize that's important. We all have had to deal with things like that in our lives. And probably will, again, further going on. How much time we spend doing different things. What's your priority? It's always important. I've told my wife many times, and I've told other people this. I hear people say, I don't have time. It amazes me. We find time to do what we want to do. If I want to do it, I'll make time, no matter what it is. But what if it's something that I really need to be doing because it affects my relationship with God? I've got to get to the point where I really want to do it, so I'll make sure I make time to do that. And you'll ask people, well, you know, I didn't have time to do that. Well, what did you do? Sit down sometime and just put down what you spent your time doing in a particular day. And you'd be amazed how much time you waste or how much time you spend doing things that don't pertain to the things God has that He wants you to do. And if you just change priorities around, you'll have plenty of time to do the things that God wants you to do. Building that relationship with Him is so important. Let's take a look now in 85 at verses 8. Well, let's just go ahead and read through the end of the psalm, beginning with verse 8. It says, I will listen to what God the Lord says. He promises peace to His people, His faithful servants, but let them not turn to folly. Surely His salvation is near to those who fear Him, that His glory may dwell in our land. Love and faithfulness meet together. Righteousness and peace kiss each other. Faithfulness springs forth from the earth, and righteousness looks down from heaven. The Lord will indeed give what is good, and our land will yield its harvest. Righteousness goes before Him and prepares the way for His steps. Again, what I'm always noticing here is that he's saying, we're going to listen to what God says and we're going to make changes. And we just talked about that a little bit. I'm going to open my ears. I'm going to hear what He says. And we as a nation need to hear what He says and make changes. We got to get on board. We got to get things squared away. And then again, it goes into from verse 9, again, praising God, talking about His wonderful attributes. What does He say here? Salvation is near those who fear Him, that His glory may dwell in our land. Talking about love and faithfulness. The Lord will indeed give us what is good. God has no desire to give us bad things. He wants us to have good things. He wants us to be blessed. God wants to bless us more than we want to be blessed. But He's looking at it saying, you know, everything, pretty much everything in life is conditional. We seem to think sometimes it's not. But as far as the way things happen with God, a lot of things are conditional. He says, for instance, if my people who are called by my name humble themselves and pray and turn from their wicked ways, then He's going to hear from heaven, heal their land, and so forth. You know the scripture that we've read many times. But it's conditional. If they do these things, then I'll do these things. And He's waiting on us quite often. He wants to bless us so much, but He's waiting on us. We talked about this a little last week. If you get blessed, what are you going to do with it? Are you going to blow it all on yourself? Are you going to use it to help others? Are you going to use it to help spread the kingdom? What are you going to do with it? And when He sees that, then what I've seen about God is, when He sees how you're going to react to His blessing and you use it to help bless others, He's going to bless you more. When He sees how you react with that, He'll bless you more. But He's waiting to see what you're going to do with it. There are people, you know, we've talked about this, I think, a few times. There's people who have no business winning the lottery. I keep thinking, I say, Lord, I think I could handle it. I'd like to win the lottery just one time. I'm not looking for 600 million. You just give me a couple. I think I could do okay. Just a little bit. I think I could handle that. But you know, it's amazing when you read stories of people who win $200, $300 million and within less than 6 months they're broke. They don't know how to handle it. They can't. And there's some people that if God really blessed the way He'd like to, He doesn't because He knows they can't handle it. They'd be messed up as bad as some of these folks are. So as we show Him our faithfulness and as we show Him that we have responsibility and we can handle the blessings and we're going to use them the right way and we're going to do and help further His kingdom, when we're blessed, then He'll put more blessings upon us. But I'm just always amazed here in so many of the Psalms where they start, even though they've got a problem, praising God for how good He is. They may talk about their problem, but before they stop, they're praising God again for all of His goodness. And that's where we need to get, where we don't hang around and get so caught up with our problems, but we move on and realize what a wonderful God we serve and how He can take care of us. We're going to move on over to Psalm 89. 89 is another one that's very interesting. The first few verses, and this is a long one, so I may not read all of it, but if you look at the first 18 verses, 1 through 18, it says, I will sing of the Lord's great love forever. With my mouth I will make your faithfulness known through all generations. Again, we see the first few verses are once again praise and worship and talking about the wonderful attributes of God. That's the first thing they start with here. How wonderful God is. Talking about His promises, talking about His faithfulness, talking about how great His love is. How the writer is, again, praising God and saying, out of my mouth, I'm going to make your faithfulness known. I'm going to share things about you. Now, later on, as we go through this psalm, one of the issues is this psalm was written saying, it looks like, Lord, you've broken your promise about keeping someone on the throne from David's line. You know, God made a promise to David that someone from his line would be on the throne of Israel forever. Now, they took it to mean physically. Well, unfortunately, a lot of these kings, and especially the last one that's talked about here, Jehoiakim, got into sin, led the people astray, and they ended up going into exile. And after this last one was removed, there was never another physical king from David's line that was put on the throne. As a matter of fact, after this time, there really wasn't a king ever active from Israel. Well, we're getting there, Jim. Don't get ahead of it. But there wasn't a physical king. See, that's what they thought. See, this is the problem. We tend to live in the physical. We talk about we are not just physical beings. We're spirit beings that live in a fleshly body, and we can see all this physical stuff. But there's more to it than what we can see. Spirit world is bigger. The spirit world has more going on in it than anything going on out here. But see, unless God opens your spiritual eyes, you don't see that. Once in a while, He may open them up just enough for you to get a glimpse. But there's a lot going on. Now, as Jim pointed out, these guys were so worried and thought so much about the fact that it had to be a physical person on the throne in Jerusalem. But David, the covenant with David, the ultimate king was Jesus. A lot of his, he said, you know, my throne is not an earthly throne. It's going to be. There will be. When he comes back, he'll set up an earthly throne. But his throne is spiritual. There's a kingdom of heaven, as he talked about. He rules there. But boy, these guys, you know, were so narrow. Do you remember, I think Vernon was talking about this in one of our services. It may have been Thursday when we were talking about it, but Jesus has risen from the grave. He's given his disciples some instruction, and he's telling them excuse me, go to Jerusalem, tarry there, don't leave until you've been endued with power from on high. Go there and wait for the gift of the Holy Spirit. And one of them asked, Lord, are you going to set up your kingdom here on earth now? That had zip zero to do with what he was even talking about. But you could see where their minds were. Here he is, raised from the dead, talking about being filled with the Spirit of God. And their concern was, when are you going to set your kingdom up here on earth? This is just a... See, we're so limited in our finite minds. I can't fathom this, guys, and I'm not going to try to tell you that I can. But when the Bible tells us that we're going to live forever, seeing people who live to be over 100, that seems like a long time to me. Now, I know according to the Bible, there used to be people live a whole lot longer, 200, 300, 400 years. But if we see anybody now over 100, that's a long time. All I can see is my existence on this earth. But you know, it's just a short time, because after we die, we don't cease to exist. We're just starting on the next leg of the journey. And it's the one that's going to last forever. But we can't see that. And that's the problem with Israel and the people at that time was they couldn't understand that what I see in the physical is such a small portion of what reality is. Jesus came to sit on that throne. He continues to sit on that throne and will always sit on that throne. God didn't break that covenant. He just basically moved it from a physical, for a period of time, throne, someone sitting on a physical throne, to someone sitting on a spiritual, supernatural throne that he's going to unite at some point again. But there's somebody sitting on that throne right now, and his name is Jesus. They can't see that, but boy, he's still there. Now, this was the thing. Judah had been defeated by the Babylonians between 605 and 586. And that says that brought a temporary end on the earth to that kingship through David. His big thing was, the writer of this psalm, was not that God wasn't in the right by punishing the people because they've messed up. But his thing was, hey, it looks like you broke your promise, God. You said there'd be somebody from David's line on the throne the whole time. But God kept that promise. He just didn't do it the way the writer of the psalm thought he would. They didn't get their earthly king back. They didn't get any other Davidic king for its earthly throne. But it did get Jesus. God fulfilled his covenant with David, not by putting an infinite series of Davidic kings on Israel's throne, but by establishing one Davidic descendant as the eternal King of Kings. That's a big statement right there. They thought, well, you know, this guy will be king, and he'll have a son, and he'll be king, and he'll just keep going on and on and on. Well, you don't need to do that when you've got one king who is eternal. And he can sit on the throne forever, and you don't have to worry about anything changing. He's going to be there and in control from then on. And that's what God was trying to show them. It's amazing. We tend to miss things because we live in this fleshly world. We're carnal. They were carnal. They wanted to see it. They wanted it to be done in there and what they could see on earth. We tend to get that way too. We want to see it here. But God has a plan. that plan not always, but most of the time, gets fulfilled in ways that we don't anticipate and in ways that we don't think about, because He operates in such a higher plane than we do. What does the Word say? It says, "My ways are not your ways, and my thoughts are not your thoughts." And it's because we're down here and God's up here. I just want sometimes for Him to let me in on some of the stuff He's got going on up there. I know that I can't handle everything that He's got going on. But once in a while, I just like to get a little bit more of a glimpse of what He's got going on up there. Once in a while, He'll open the door a little bit and show us just a little glimpse. But the thing for us to realize is, even when we're in trouble, when there's problems, when things aren't going the way we want them to, He's still worthy to be praised. That's when we really should be praising Him, because He's got it all figured out. I've been accused of, and especially now since I've been home quite a bit, you try to figure things out. You try to spend too much time trying to figure things out. And sometimes you just can't do that. And yes, I've been guilty of that. But the good thing is I don't have to worry about figuring everything out, because He's already got it all figured out. All I really want to do is say, "Okay, Lord, You got it figured out. Just put a little bit of that wisdom in me, so I know a little bit about what's going on." But we serve a good God who wants the best for us. That's what we're excited about. Even in the midst of all these issues and Psalms, they would start with praise and they would end with praise. They may have problems in between, but that's how they dealt with them, and that's what we need to learn to do. Praise Him when it's hard, because that's when we really need to praise Him the most, because He's gonna come to the rescue. And then don't forget to praise Him after He does answer your prayers and take care of the issues. The Lord be with you. Absolutely.